First of all, I would like to thank everybody for coming today. I really appreciate you joining us. And we'd like to also thank our sponsors, Gateway Technical College, for this great space. For those of you who haven't been here, they remodeled it less than a year ago. It's just a really great space. So hope that you end up coming to more events here. But we appreciate their sponsorship of today's event with the space and all the audiovisual. Everybody's been great. I also want to thank Eddie Old Impressions for videotaping this so that we have an archive that we can share with other people. Especially want to thank our speakers, some of whom traveled from Madison today to be here this morning, so really appreciate that. I want to run through the format a little bit. We're going to have Scott Buttons, who will come up and speak first, do a brief presentation about venture investors. His firm, but also really kind of talk about the venture capital market in Wisconsin. And then we'll have Ron Dollins, who is the director of the Wisconsin Angel Network, talk about the network and the different angel groups that are in the area. Randy McIntyre will follow him. That's a little change in the schedule. And he's with the State Light Angels, so we'll talk specifically about some of the things that they're looking to do. Then we have John Jacoby, who will talk about his successful crowdfunding experience last year. We also have Lynn McGuigan from Kiva, who will join us by speakerphone, so hopefully that all that technology will work out. And then Alan Larson will kind of tie things up and balance it out with a perspective on what the traditional banking environment is. So really the purpose today is for us to kind of learn a little bit more about some of this funding so that we can hopefully harness and tap into that for our startups and for our businesses here to help encourage more growth and expansion. So with that, I'd like to have our first speaker, Scott Buttons, come up.
Good morning. Maybe you're getting the slides up. I'll give you a little background. So I actually grew up in Lake Geneva, so it's fun to come back home. And I was a little concerned that crossing the county line, that the sheriff might meet me and not let me in. So I made it undercover. But I grew up in Lake Geneva. I went to college at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, engineering undergraduate, worked for Rockwell Automation for 5 years, and then got my business degree at the University of Chicago. Actually worked for McDonald's Corporation of all places for a period of time, and then joined Venture Investors back in 1996. So with that, what I'm going to do is give you a brief overview of our firm and what we do, and then talk more generally about our industry and maybe where it fits in the continuum of sources of capital for startups and early stage businesses. So Venture Investors was a firm formed back in 1982. We're a seed and early stage venture capital fund. We have 6 investment partners. We are a diverse fund. We invest both in the life sciences and digital health, as well as in technology and material sciences. We have 6 funds under management and over $250 million under management, and which is a lot of money, but I'll tell you, in the scheme of things, we're a relatively small fund on a national basis, although for a regional fund, we're a decent sized fund. So our headquarters is in Madison, and then we also have an office in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And you might say, well, why is it in those places? And the reality is, our investment thesis is identifying really interesting technologies and discoveries out of the major research institutions throughout the Midwest. And as you probably know, in any given year, you know, the Midwest is home to at least 10 of the top 50 research institutions. And Madison and Ann Arbor are always respectively in the top 5, and each do over $1 billion worth of research. And across the region, you have over $9 billion worth of research. Obviously, a lot of that's basic research, but our thesis is a small percentage of that will be ideas and discoveries that can be turned into companies. So here's a smattering of some of the portfolio companies that we have in our portfolio, and as you can see, it's fairly diverse. It's anything from hardcore life sciences, such as a company is Promega, which makes diagnostics and research products, all the way over to a company such as Silotronics, which is a university spin-out that is developing novel organosilanes for use in electrolytes and lithium-ion batteries. And actually, they're in discussions with three of the five largest lithium-ion battery manufacturers throughout the world and incorporating their products in their batteries to improve the performance and safety. How many of you, anybody ever had the LASIK surgery? Anyone's had LASIK surgery in this audience? Yes? Did you have the all laser LASIK surgery?
I did, yeah.
You did. So it turns out that one of our portfolio companies, Intralase, was the inventor of enabling the corneal flap to be cut with a laser. It was technology developed out of the University of Michigan and has been commercialized and really was the part of the all laser LASIK surgery. And so you likely had the Intralase procedure for your surgery. And then it turns out that same group of founders went on to start another company called LensX. And the idea there was to apply lasers to cataract surgery, so to take the variability out of it and make it repeatable so that even the less skilled surgeons could perform as highly as the highly skilled surgeons. So we're a very diverse investor, and like I say, just a snapshot of some of the companies that we've invested in. So what is venture capital? So at the end of the day, what do? So we go out and we raise pools of capital from institutional investors. We take those proceeds and then we identify startup companies that are in need of capital, and then we invest in those companies. And the investment is really coming in the form of an equity stake, i.e. we're purchasing ownership in these companies. And then our business is both obviously in identifying investment opportunities as well as then in managing those. And so it's not something where you make your investment and then 5 years later the owner calls you up and says, hey, I've sold the company and here are your proceeds. The reality is our business is a hands-on sport, and so we're very involved and active in these companies and try to be value add. So we take board positions in these companies. We're long-term investors. Often, our hold is anywhere from 5 to 8 years or longer in these particular companies. And then at the end of the day, obviously it's wealth creation. And we always joke, but the idea is to buy low and sell high. And as you know, with many startups and many early stage businesses, the failure rate is often very, very high. And certainly that's the case for what we do. So why is it needed? Well, as I said, I think the statistic is, over half of small businesses fail. And in our world, close to 40 to 50, often 60% of early stage, high technology, high risk investments fail. And so the reality is, anybody here from a lending institution, it's unlikely that they're going to be willing to fund a professor with an idea with a bank loan. And so really the only form of capital is venture capital. And so those are the types of opportunities we fund. They're high risk, they're high reward. And frankly, the institutions such as pension funds and endowments, they don't have the capacity or ability to be making direct investments. Banks aren't a player in this business. And often angel investors are big components of sources of funding for startups, but there's certainly oftentimes situations where the business model or the form of the company just needs a lot more capital than any single individual can provide, and that's really where venture capital comes into play. So, it's a cottage industry. Since 1970, over close to $460 billion has been invested by venture capital funds, which, as you know, when you compare it to the mutual fund industry or some of the other financial industries, it's a relatively small business. But the reality is it's had a pretty profound impact. I mean, I'm sure you're well aware and your lives are touched by these names every day. And it turns out that 11% of the private sector employment are companies that were funded by venture capital funds, and 21% of GDP is produced by venture-backed companies. And I think, as we all know, net job creation or job growth is not coming from Fortune 500 companies. It's coming from small business and startups. So we'll talk a little bit about just the continuum of financing. So in our world, you have ideas, and in our case, as professors walk in and they say, I have a discovery. And at some point, you get to proof of concept, you get to a product, you get to a product launch. And what you see here is just the various sources of funding that come into play. And so, we as the venture investors, our focus is anywhere from the seed stage to the early stage and somewhat to the growth stage as far as where we'll get involved in the company as a source of funding. And, at the earliest stages, often it's the friends and family that are the earliest funders. At some point, angels or high net worth individuals come into play. than the venture capital funds. And then there's later stage venture capital funds that are more interested in funding growth than taking on some of the early technology risk. And then oftentimes with the things that we work with, a lot of these companies also seek grant funding through SBR and National Science Foundation grants. And at some point, you know, as they become growing concerns, they become bankable. But in today's banking world, at least what we see, and particularly around Madison, is, you know, unless you have 2 or 3 years of profitability, it's rare that you can get traditional bank loans to these companies. And frankly, it's rare that our companies ever achieve that form of profitability before they're acquired. So often traditional banking sources just aren't a source of financing for these companies. And there's specialty lenders out there, such as Silicon Valley Bank and others. You know, this poor guy, you know, the moral of the story is venture capital is hard to raise. You know, we see over 300 opportunities a year. We fund 2 or 3. And this guy's in the process of inventing the wheel and trying to figure out where he can raise some startup capital. So how does the process work? This is a relationship business. You know, we have a website and we get, you know, hundreds of inbound opportunities on a monthly basis. And the reality is we've never funded anything that isn't come through a network source. And so, you know, if you're an entrepreneur looking for capital, the best thing you can do is use your network to find someone who knows someone that's an investor or an angel investor. Because the idea of just blindly launching in a business plan to a funding source, the likelihood of getting funding is almost nothing or nil. And the process is, it's a first meeting, it's you know, finding a champion within a fund, you know, then that partner taking it back to their partnership saying, hey, I think this is interesting, you're talking about within the partnership and deciding, gee, we want to put resources against it to do due diligence. And then at that point, you really roll up your sleeves and you use all your resources and your abilities to try to figure out what are the risks of this deal, can I make money, you know, do I need to bring in other sitting-in partners into the deal? And I always like to tell the story that, you know, what's harder than getting a venture capitalist to say yes is to get them to say no. Because the easiest thing you can do, right, is sit on the sideline and say, well, no, not now, but, you know, why don't you come back in 6 months and show me a little more customer traction. So it's always a thorn in the side for entrepreneurs as far as getting a financier to actually say no. So I won't dwell on this, but, you know, at the end of the day, what we're looking for is it's a home run business. I mean, we need to find opportunities that have the potential any single company to return the whole fund that's under management. And so we're looking for really disruptive technologies, evolutionary technologies, and particularly when we're working with the university environment, it's really easy to see lots of whiz-bang technologies, but at some point you have to step back and say, is it really solving a real market opportunity or a real market problem? Is it really a better mousetrap? And obviously, as we all know, some of you might be too young to remember, I mean, when Google launched, there were many, many search engines out there, but Google came with a novel technology, a new page ranking system that really disrupted that industry, and they were able, obviously, to launch a very, very successful business. And, you know, the other moral of the story is, I mean, we can all think of technologies where the best technology doesn't win. And in the bottom line, it's about teams, it's about execution. Of course, we'd love to have world-class technologies in the things we fund, but at the end of the day, if we have to make a choice, we'll choose the A team and the B technology all day long if we have to make that choice. So at the end of the day, you'll hear this repeated theme, at least from us and our businesses, it's all about the team and finding credible leaders to run these organizations. And particularly with what we do, when it's, you know, academics or professors, obviously these aren't seasoned business leaders. So one of our biggest challenges is when we find an interesting idea or interesting technology is, one, are the founders open to bringing in the right leadership? And if they're not, it's probably not a right fit for us. And two, if they are, can we wrap the right leadership around these companies to take them to their fullest potential? As I had mentioned, I mean, everything that we get into, it needs to have that potential to return 10 to 15 times our investment, because the failure rate's pretty high. And at the end of the day, we're trying to net a 2 to 3x net return to our investors with our funds. The other thing I'd point out as far as market size is, just to make the economics work to create the exits that we look for, you know, we really need to have addressable markets that are in excess of $250 million, so pretty sizable markets. And we meet a lot of entrepreneurs with really interesting ideas attacking smaller markets. And I'm almost apologetic, because there's many, many great business opportunities that are serving, you know, 10, 15, and $20 million niches where they can create a really nice business. It's just our capital is not the right source of financing, but that doesn't mean that it's not a legitimate business. So here's the general makeup of a fund, and I won't dwell on it, but you know, at the end of the day, as I said, if say we had a theoretical $50 million fund, we're trying to return three times that fund back to the investors. So we raised $50 million, and then at the end of the day, when the fund's all wrapped up, we're at Hopes, we're trying to return $150 million back to our investors. And so here's a general makeup of the fund, and the point being is that if you look at that, you know, close to 75% of the fund is losing money. And it's really that top 10% that's driving the returns in a fund. And if you're an early stage investor, that's really the nature of our business. And so that's why everything that we look at, we really want to see home run potential, because we know, unfortunately, the failure rate is going to be fairly high. And we got to make sure when we have a winner, it produces the appropriate returns to drive the fund. And if you break it down to a company level, this is kind of a theoretical company. So say you're a founder, and you know, here you are, you invested $100,000 into your company. Obviously, at that point, you still own the whole company. But at some point, you go out and you raise some seed capital. In this case, the example shows they raised seed money of $1 million. And in the vernacular that we're doing, we have a pre-money of $2 million. So the investor said, we value your company at $2 million. We're going to put $1 million in. And we're valuing the post money at $3 million, i.e. we bought a third of your company. So the seed investors own a third after that investment, and you just go down. And oftentimes in a venture-backed companies, you have different series of rounds of financing. So you have a Series A financing. In this case, they raised $5 million. The B round was $10 million. The C round was $15 million. And at some point in this example, they did an IPO. And what you can see is, you know, at the end of the day, the founders end up owning about 16% of the company, but they own a piece of the pie that's worth about $48 million. And so one of the mindsets of the founders oftentimes in a venture-backed company is they're probably not going to own the majority of the company, and they have to kind of come to grips with that. And the idea is own a smaller piece of a much larger pie. And you know, that's in some cases, that's not what founders are interested in. And you know, it's part of our job to just educate founders about that and make sure that if they want to go down the venture capital path, this is what the likely ownership stake they might end up with at the end of the day. Okay, so now we're just gonna flip over and talk about some of the fun stuff that we've invested in and what these companies look like and where they are today. And as I mentioned, obviously we fund a lot of things coming out of University of Madison. And this, we work very closely with WARF. WARF is the licensing arm. Anything that's research that's funded federally, the dollars that, or the discoveries have to run through WARF to be licensed. And so this is a classic example of the way our business works. So you see the two gentlemen on the right, the physician and the man in blue. Fred Lee, the physician, he's a top five interventional radiologist throughout the world. He's a well-known key opinion leader. And then the engineering professor, he's probably one of the brightest guys on campus. He's an electrical engineering professor. And they had this thesis that said, radio frequency is used often in various treatments, whether it be surgery or ablation or cardiac. And they felt that the use of microwave as an energy modality was far superior to radio frequency. So with their own dollars, they put $250,000 into a device that you see in the left, and it kind of looks like something that was cottoned together with duct tape and a little glue, and produced this first system. And their thesis was that we could use microwave, or they could use microwave, to minimally invasively treat cancer tumors, particularly in the lung, liver, kidney. And so they licensed some technology that they had created on campus through WARF. They formed the company. We got involved. And at that point, we said, gee, this is really interesting. We think there's a real unique market opportunity for this. But you know, we need to find leadership for this company before we would write a check. And so we identified the lady on the lower left there, Laura King. She was running GE's billion-dollar interventional business. She had left, she was looking for the next thing to do, so we put she together with the founders, and one day they called up and said, well, what do you think about Laura as our CEO? Will that be fantastic? And they're like, oh, she'd be too expensive, she's too experienced. We're like, absolutely not, guys. If the chemistry's there, she'd be a fabulous leader. And so that was the day that she put a business plan together, and we put together a $5 million round of financing for the company, which is called New Wave Medical. And so what are they doing? In short is, if you're diagnosed with liver cancer, you know, the gold standard is to have a surgical resection. And I mean, they literally open you up,
They cut through the liver, they identify the tumor, they resect it, remove it. You're often in a hospital for anywhere from 6 to 8 days. Obviously, the recovery period is substantial. The alternative is what they do is they through image guidance, they place a probe in the middle of the tumor, they turn on energy, they ablate the tumor for 5 minutes. It's often the same procedure, really, in terms of there has to be a better way to conform the therapy to the tumor without hitting the surrounding tissues. And so he was called us up, and we went down to his lab. It was in the bowels of the university. And that's what this thing looked like. Yet he was telling us his vision was to create this. And obviously, as you know, with radiation therapy, if something goes wrong, it can be catastrophic to the patient. And so this was a big, big idea. They had over 80 patents that were going to be licensed out of war. GE actually had funded the original research on campus. And so we helped them. And they came to us saying they needed $12 million of financing. Well, our fund was $15 million. There was no way we could do that. Well, it turns out that if they got $3 million, they could reduce a tremendous amount of risk. And from that, raise further capital. And so we helped them with the finance strategy. So this company turned out to be very successful, did an IPO, achieved over $200 million of revenue. We ultimately invested about $7.5 million in the company and turned that into $75 million return for our fund. You know, obviously, the neat thing about it is, of course, that we've made money for our investors, but the reality is, you know, we changed patient care. Tomotherapy has set the standard for radiation therapy and conformal therapy today, and all market leaders now have systems that do similar things, and it's had a huge impact on outcomes in the patient lives. And then just lastly, because we're running on time, we're short on time, and this is a project that we have not invested in. It's technology out of University of Nebraska. And on the right is the Da Vinci robotic surgical system. It's a $2 million piece of capital equipment. As you can see, it's a huge extracorporeal robot that they go in and do surgical procedures. And the basic idea here is to create a miniaturized robotic system that you place within the body to do these surgeries and be much less minimally invasive. And it's something we've been tracking, we've been watching. I've been watching it for 5 years. And it's the types of things that we keep on our radar, and maybe at some point we become an investor in the company. So with that, again, it's a people business. It's all about trying to identify the risks that you do, that you know. You have to take a long-term approach. You know, never underestimate the competition. And, you know, like to say, we go into these opportunities with our eyes wide open and give tremendous credit to the entrepreneurs. I mean, I think in our business, a lot of venture capitalists try to take too much credit for the successes, and the reality is it's all about really finding really brilliant people, really great leaders, and investing and trusting in their capabilities. So,
by myself, I got started. Well, I got my undergrad degree at Carroll University over in Waukesha. Born and raised in Belgium, so if you listen closely, you might be able to hear my accent. But I kind of rolled in this industry as the associate director of the Golden Angels Investors. It's an angel group out of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And I worked for them for 4 years while I got my master's degree at Marquette University. So today, kind of a short agenda, I'll give you an introduction on the Tech Council, the Wisconsin Technology Council, and the Wisconsin Angel Network, and then focus on just angel investing, what it is, what it takes to do that. And then I'll share some data both for the U.S. and for the state of Wisconsin. So the Tech Council, we are a nonprofit, nonpartisan, independent organization. We're 14 years old, and we're actually founded through a state mandate. The governor at that time saw the need for a statewide technology council. We have a board of about 50 people, executives from both small and large companies. We have people from educational research. We have some service providers. And we're there to advise the governor on policies and help advance the technology industry here in the state of Wisconsin. The way that we do that, we have two kind of main programs. First one on the left is the Wisconsin Innovation Network. And we have a lot of, that's kind of our membership subsidiary. We have chapters in Madison, Milwaukee. We actually have one in by Lake Superior up in Ashland. We have one in Fox Valley, central Wisconsin. So we're kind of spread out all over the state. And we organize regular meetings where people get to meet each other, and also some educational seminars for members. The Wisconsin Angel Network, bottom right, I'm the director of that. And we are here to serve as a resource for the different angel groups or early stage investors like Scott's, and then Randy, who you'll hear talk next. We're here as a resource for them. If they're looking to grow their group, if they're looking to start new groups, I make a lot of introductions between entrepreneurs and investors and try to kind of align what they're looking for. So how do we do it? As you can see, we have a lot of different programs, and I won't go into all of them, but I'd like to point out one of them, ESS, down at the bottom right. That's our early stage symposium, and I'm going to make a shameless plug here for our upcoming event. November 4th and 5th, it's in Madison. It's a great meeting. It's a two-day meeting. We're expecting about 500 to 600 people. We'll have 40 different companies presenting their ideas, and we'll have about 50 investors there, both in Wisconsin and from out of state. And I invited Flocks to come and present, and I think it could be a great addition to the group. It seems like Scott and I have a lot of shared slides. You saw the financing continue, but again, founders, friends, and family. And I'm going to kind of focus on the angel groups aspect of it and kind of what it is and what it takes to get from them. So what is an angel investor? Now this is important. To be considered an angel investor, you also have to be accredited. And we'll get into the definition here shortly. But it's people who invest their own money. The companies they invest in are high risk, high growth, early stage companies. So the idea and the market opportunity, as Scott mentioned, are really important and something that investors pay a lot of attention to. Promising startups, as you can tell, 90% of their funds come from angel groups or the investors that follow on, so they are an important cog in the kind of the machine. Accredited investors, here's the definition. So your net worth has to be at least $1 million. Share it with your spouse if you have one. And it can't include your primary residence. Or your annual income exceeds $200,000 each of the two most recent years. So a lot of the angel investors are pretty affluent people. And that is key because it is high risk. You're not guaranteed your money back. So we have to make sure that the people that are allowed to invest can afford it. An angel network, and I'll just touch on this briefly. I mean, it comes down to strength in numbers, and there's a lot of benefit to doing something as a group. You share the burden of the due diligence. As Scott showed, it takes quite a while to go through the different aspects of the business to make sure that it's a right fit. So if you can share that with a group of people, not only in time, but also the money spent, it kind of helps. And I'll leave it at that. Randy will be talking about that a little more in depth. So there's a lot of misconceptions, and since I made this presentation last a couple months ago, I actually included this slide. We are not economic development. If there's some freestanding or some open space on Main Street, angel investing is not going to fill that up. As Scott mentioned, return on investment is key, and job creation will flow from that. Actually saw a stat that startups provide a lot of the majority of the job creation within an area, so angel investing can help with that. It's also not a guaranteed success, and you heard Scott talk about home runs, but I like to kind of use an analogy with baseball, right? If you bat 300, you're considered an all-star. So out of 10 opportunities, that means that 7 times your company will fail or your investment will fail. But of the 3 that are success, that includes singles, doubles, and triples. And ultimately, you're going for those home runs, so it's risky. It's not you have to watch out. And it's also not a quick way to get rich. It's not like when you invest your money, you're going to get it right back. Average is 3 to 7 years, kind of depending on what industry you're in. The examples that Scott shared are usually longer-term plays because you most of the time will need FDA approval. If you're information technology or software, you're usually looking at a quicker exit. So now some statistics. In 2014, there were 316,000 active investors. Based on the definition of an accredited investor that I shared earlier, so the $1 million net worth or $200,000 net income, there's 4 million eligible investors in the United States. So one part of my job is trying to get more people engaged in angel investing and contributing more money so more companies can get funded, more jobs can be created, and so forth. Last year alone, $24.1 billion was invested in the U.S. So it's quite a nice chunk of change. And of the $24 billion, that came down to about 73,000 different companies. Average annual investments is between $200,000 and $800,000. I think the average I saw a stat was around $250,000 to $300,000 per age group. So some trends, as you can see, in the Great Lakes area, we're actually pretty active, only behind California, so that's a good sign. With a lot of the research universities around this area, there's a lot of great opportunities for angel investors to find good companies to invest in. Wisconsin Angels, that picture on the right is actually an annual publication that we create with the Wisconsin Technology Council. And I survey all of the angel groups or all the different investor groups and kind of try to track all of the Wisconsin companies that received funding. So what we know of, for example, in 2014, we had 113 companies receiving funding, which is actually a 31% increase versus 2013 for a total of $346 million. Now, you might say, oh, that's a big jump. Numbers are slightly skewed. We had one company, Shine Medical, who received a term sheet for $125 million. So if you take that out, it increased a little bit. But 2015, so year to date, so for the past 8.5 months, 75 companies for $155 million. So we are increasing, and that is the correct trend, and that's something that we're excited to see. There's a lot of different angel groups, ventures investors at the top, and then State Line Angels here at the bottom are just two of the different groups that are out there in the state. And here you can kind of see a map. We have 35 different groups in the state that are actively investing. And as you take a look at Walworth County, on the bottom, there's no star there, but there are plenty of angel groups close by. And that's kind of my call to action for you. If you have an interest in becoming an angel investor and you meet the definition, Randy will talk and introduce an event that's upcoming in September, but we are open to receiving new members, or if you're looking to start one, I'd be more than happy to talk to you as well. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Randy. For his presentation on State Line Angels.
The beauty of following these two guys is half of my slides I don't have to go over now. especially the beginning. What I'm going to do mostly is focus on, you know, an example of what one angel group is doing with the state. By no means is what we're doing the same as what everybody else is doing, but it is one example and it works for us. Most angel groups will, first of all, invest close to home. And I think maybe what you heard from Scott, if you could divide that by 10 or 20, that's what angels are doing. I mean, the size of our deals, our involvement in the deals is much less than at the venture. And as you saw on his slide, we tend to invest earlier to provide the funding to get it up to a point where then major dollars through venture or private equity funds can then take it over. But other than that, I mean, I think if you think of the things that Scott mentioned and divide it by 10 or 20, that's where the angels play. We tend to invest close to home. It's small companies. There is some level of mentoring and consulting. We're not gonna be as active as Scott and the private equity guys, but we certainly are gonna help the small companies. Generally, there's a lot of the angels that are former business owners or current business owners, so they have a lot of knowledge in that standpoint. And you've already heard about risk and exit strategies. You saw something very similar to this from Scott. I'm going to kind of just go through these. Job creation is a big thing. And then I think this is probably the one for the investors out there. And you've heard about risk and generally, you know, Scott's group, I think you said 3 to 7, Scott, or 5 to 7 years. And, you know, angels are going to be 3 to 7 years. I mean, this is not going to be a fast turnaround. for an investor, you want to make sure you have a balanced portfolio. You heard the baseball analogy of 3 out of 10 and you're an all-star. So you don't want to just invest in one or two companies. You need to build your portfolio. And being part of an angel group gives you that exposure to a number of different opportunities to do that. You know, we talk about, you know, 1 to 3 companies per year. You're building up your portfolio over a number of years. Again, some of the things that Bram mentioned, that 1 or 2 out of investments are going to basically make your portfolio work. And it's got to be a fairly small percentage of your overall portfolio. I mean, this can't be the money that you expect to live on. This is the high risk portion of your total net worth. Okay, now specifically about our group, we were founded in 2006. State line would be Winnebago County, i.e. Rockford, Illinois, and Rock County, which is Beloit, Janesville, and the surrounding counties. I have to say it's mostly that area today. We've made 17 investments since then, investing over $7 million. If I exclude one sort of outlier, our average investment has been $250,000. Our mission, without reading it, I think you heard from these guys, leading edge technology. We're not going to invest in the new coffee shop on Main Street. Based on what, you know, how this works, and you've heard from both these guys on these risk-adjusted returns. But the other thing that angels get beyond that is there is a feeling of supporting economic development. We're not doing it for that reason, but we do know that we're bringing jobs to an area. Some of the angels do like to get involved in mentoring. All of us, you know, what you learn, these new technologies, if you're a curious person, I think you'd enjoy what you hear at our meetings and learning about the business opportunities that are out there. Of the 17 investments we've made, you can see it's a fairly diverse set of investment sectors. And I will say the software for us tended to be, I think I heard this, Scott say, digital healthcare. I mean, we haven't invested in the, let's say, the typical web applications, but more digital technology that's applied to various businesses, healthcare being one. In terms of the stage, right there at the very bottom, you see we've had 5 that have either been, I'll say, below average exits or just plain dead. Okay, this is high risk. We've already had some strikeouts. We move on. In some ways, having a strikeout early is good because you're not putting more and more money into it. So you do have to recognize where it is. Obviously, the ones that are near the top, the growth and early revenues, are the ones that we're very excited about, and that's where we're going to get our return from. What we look for in particular, we want a business that can generate at least $50 million in revenues. I'll say most of them will come to us and make it through our screening process, have an opportunity to get much larger than that. We need a strategy. Number 3 is about what are the barriers to market? How do you protect the business that you have, whether it's patents, first mover advantage, whatever it is? I think number 4, Scott mentioned this, the most important thing by far is the management team. I like what he said, if I had a choice between an A technology and a B management team, or B technology and an A management team, you take the A management team. We've learned the hard way. I can look at those 5 failures we've had. It's been the team. It's been management. We also have to have an exit strategy. There's no way to get your money out until the company has been sold. These are not what we call lifestyle businesses, where somebody builds a wonderful $20 million business and they can live off this very happily. Those are great businesses. They're just not the ones that angels would be looking for. And then a reasonable valuation. So just to kind of walk through, this is the outlier. So I'm going to just walk through a handful of the ones we've invested. This is the outlier. It's a Beloit. It was a Madison, now Beloit-based company to produce molybdenum-99, which is used for medical it's a medical radioisotope used for imaging. Right now, all of the molybdenum comes from overseas. North Star is aiming to be the first U.S. producer of the molybdenum. Again, factory is up in Beloit. And I say this as an outlier. We came in, I'll say, beyond siege stage and sort of alongside a private equity investor who has continued to support this. And we've also gotten a lot of support from the Department of Energy because the Department of Energy is looking to, right now, all the molybdenum is made using highly enriched uranium, which is bomb-making material. And they want to eliminate that as the process to produce molybdenum. So the Department of Energy has been supporting various methods to try to make molybdenum 99 without highly enriched uranium. So we're very high on North Star, and it is a local company for us. Physician software is technology that came out of Mayo. This is this digital healthcare. So it's how do we use software to improve patient services, and at the same time we can reduce the cost by managing the ESA dosaging to patients for undergoing kidney dialysis. Tracer, you've all heard of X-rays. Tracer is Terra rays, which is a different part of the spectrum, and the ability for Terra rays, each of the spectrums of light can do different things. With Terra rays, you can actually look through solid objects. So its first application is likely to be looking for inspections, for instance, looking beyond paint to see if there's cracks in the metal that would be covered by paint in aircraft, for an example. Scott mentioned, you know, the source of these businesses. We also are looking at universities quite a bit. This actually came out of Columbus, Ohio, University of Ohio State. And it's just recently been moved. Now they're at now private equity stage beyond the seed money when we invested, and they've been moved out to Silicon Valley. So we have high hopes that something positive is gonna come out of Tracer. Advanced diamond, this is the ability to produce diamond coating by using methane gas under proper conditions. As you know, diamonds are very hard and frictionless. So the applications in the industrial in the industry are significant. We were sort of a late angel group coming into this, but they're progressing, and again, an Illinois company. I'm not gonna go into all of them, but Keio's very interesting, another Madison-based company. It's putting sensors on exercise bands so that instead of just being, you know, I pulled it 10 times, you'll actually be able to measure the amount of force every single pull is giving you. So that would be very good for physical therapy. That's the initial market. They just launched in May. Another very interesting on a telehot down in Galesburg, Illinois, is they say intelligent hot water, but essentially it's instant hot water done right. I mean, I think we've all seen, you know, it eliminates the hot water tank, but because they're using intelligence and they've got software in there as well, it can actually predict your usage over time and deliver the hot water faster than most tankless systems. How we operate, again, this is where you'll see the greatest variation amongst the angel groups. In our particular case, we meet 8 times a year. Late in the day, we generally have 2 new companies that have been pre-vetted by a screening committee that we have, and we do it over a casual dinner, so we'll have the presentations and determine what we're gonna do next. Our process, obviously it's pre-screening to take maybe 15 or 20 companies that have approached us or that we found from other angel groups. The screening committee decides which ones are appropriate for us. They present at the meeting. We decide whether we have any interest. If we do have interest, we're different than most angel groups. We actually use a third party for our due diligence. It's someone who's been with us for a number of years, who came out of the licensing department of University of Illinois. So she's got great expertise in both IP and business aspects. She'll do our due diligence. Following that, we'll meet again and determine what kind of interest level, and then we form an LLC for each investment. And just as an example, you know, if we have, I don't know what the number is, 15 interested investors, some might put in 10,000, some might 15, 20, 50, whatever. For us, it's an individual decision, how much you want to invest in this particular target company. What we are doing, we're going to now supplement that process with a sidecar fund. So we're in the process of putting together a sidecar fund for angels who would be, let's say, they have less time to put in to being an angel. It is, being an angel is typically an active process. So the sidecar fund would allow more passive investors to invest alongside what the active investors are doing under very prescribed terms. It would operate like any investment fund. There's no carry in this case. There would just be the fees that the active investors are paying. And what that allows us to do, if we have, you know, $1 to $3 million fund that can invest alongside what the active investors are doing, that could perhaps double the size. So our 250 per investment might be able to go up to 400 or 500 if we have this fund. So that's something that we're going to put together here in the next few months, which would be a fairly big change for us. Some angel groups only invest in this method. So they, rather than have an individual decision like this, they will only have a fund where everybody has put in X amount of money, and it's a straight up and down vote. So all the angel groups don't, I don't mean to say we all operate the same way, but this is how we operate. If there are any interested potential angel investors in the group, we are having a meeting to kind of build our membership. It'll be September 15th at the Beloit Club. Tom Still from Wisconsin Technology Council and Bram are both gonna speak. We are gonna have George Messina, who's CEO of Northstar. George is gonna just talk about how angel investing was part of his continuum of investments. We also have someone from Hendricks Commercial Properties speak. They are going to be putting an incubator together in the Beloit area. That incubator would be a source of potential businesses that angels might invest in. So if there are interested, accredited investors, the meeting is not open to the public, but if you meet the criteria of accredited investor and are interested, you can let us know, and there's flyers in the back of the room for anybody who is interested.
So we're going to change gears because so far we've been talking about millions of dollars, and I am going to be talking about dozens of dollars. So in November of last year, I did a relatively successful Indiegogo campaign to raise $50,000. Where we're all talking about business, and I have a business, and I have employees and all that, I actually didn't raise any money or capital for the business side of what it is that I do. I don't know if you've heard of CNN or the New York Times, but they use a piece of software called WordPress. And WordPress is an open source piece of software that powers about 24% of the top 100 million websites on the internet. And it just happens to be a piece of software that I found in 2007 and hated originally. And it was awful, it didn't really work very well, it wasn't very pretty, it wasn't super user friendly. And so I was like, oh, well, it kind of does something that I want it to do. And I can take that one little something and I can improve it because it's open source. And I can see the code and I can read the code, so I can improve the code. And that piece of software had a few other little, I don't know, sister projects to it that handled internationalization, which is translating, you know, the strings, the little verbiage in the code from English to Spanish and Portuguese and Mandarin and everything else. And we had support forums and we had sort of a loose idea of a social network. But WordPress eventually is the piece of software that took off. It's blogging software traditionally, and most people individually use it for that purpose. You are one person who is blogging, or you're posting pictures of your dog, your recipes, or whatever you're doing, but then the flexibility of this software is that an entire organization like CNN that has multiple publishers, that has millions of hits a day, that has an organization that is, you know, delivering the news to the entire world, can take this exact same piece of software and use it almost out of the box with a bunch of like plugins or little modifications to it without hacking the code itself. And over time, as WordPress got more popular and people started contributing more code to WordPress specifically, all of the other sister projects sort of failed or kind of became stagnant, really. But the ironic thing about that is that while thousands of people were helping build WordPress as a piece of software, we were all using these antiquated tools to collaborate with each other. Our support forum software didn't see contributions for 3 years. It was just dead. We had a whole section for aggregating activity, like a profile, like an activity stream like you would see on Facebook, that was basically dead for like a year. And these pieces of software were the tools that we were using to collaborate with each other, and no one was actively really using them. And so my crowdfunding campaign was really to make sure that those pieces of software, our supplementary software, had momentum. So I asked for $50,000 for about 6 months worth of development time to get these pieces of software up to speed again. Basically, code review, code deployment, bring it all up to standards, bring it all up to what it is that we expect for WordPress to be. And so for crowdfunding, I think what I'll talk about, and I could talk all day, so someone's gonna have to show time at the Apollo me back to my chair. For me and for my crowdfunding campaign specifically, this was already my career. This was already something that I had been doing. Like, I have a reputation in the WordPress community for doing this, for writing code, for doing code deployments. So my background from working at a company called Automattic, they host and run WordPress.com. They host about 60 million different websites, and I did, on their VIP team, code review and deployment for CNN, for the New York Times, like going through all of their code specifically, line by line, left to right, top to bottom, and looking it over. So it's pretty boring, right? But eventually, when you break 60 million websites, it gets pretty exciting pretty quickly. So by the time that I had gotten to the point where the company, Automattic, that I was working for, wasn't really interested in these pieces of software and the support forums or the social networky profile side of it, and these were the things that I saw the most potential in myself. These were the things that needed the most work, that had sort of, they weren't the sexy thing to work on, they weren't really the popular thing to work on, but they were the thing that had the most potential to, I think, bring the biggest return on someone's investment. And so by that point, it was like, okay, well, if the company I'm working for isn't interested in it, and I'm hugely passionate and interested in it, then it's time to look outside of the company that I'm working for, and I can see an opportunity. I'm going to try and take that opportunity, so I'm going to go and start a business and have consulting and stuff that's going to happen on one side of it. But on the other side of it, there's the open source community, almost volunteer sort of side of it, where I can ask a community of people, a community of companies, a community of organizations, people that have seen me work for 10 years on sort of the whole ecosystem of software, and say, hey, you guys use it, I know you use it, I know you need it, and I know you hate it, and I want to be the guy who's going to own improving this entire experience, put together a plan, put together sort of a roadmap and a bunch of milestones on how it was, like what it was that I was going to try to accomplish. But my crowdfunding campaign was a little bit unique in that I think when you think of crowdfunding, and I'll take it back a little bit, where you think of Kickstarter, where you want to put $50 in and you want to receive a product out, right? Or you think of GoFundMe, which is another website, which is mostly for like, hey, I need $1,000 because my dog needs a surgery. Crowdfunding is, there's a huge spectrum of it where you're asking for money. You're asking the world for money. You're asking someone or whatever the group of people it is that you want for money. Whereas with Angel, you're asking for investment in an idea, but you're also looking for help. You're looking for a talent. You're looking for a group of people that know more about the business side of something that can influence you and help you and give you, one, the money that's helpful, but two, also the insight into how to actually make your business successful. Whereas with crowdfunding, it's sometimes a little bit different than that. You might be two people and you might have one tiny idea where you need to buy a machine to produce a product. So my campaign was a little bit different where I kind of didn't even promise any results. Like, I kind of said, like, this is how much money I need. This is what I think I can pull off in 6 months. Like, I basically, like, I call myself like a theoretical web developer because web technologies change so quickly and things evolve so quickly. And there are so many people that are working on things that a lot of the times we have an idea and sort of a roadmap on how things are going to go, and they're just never going to go that way. You sort of try to stick to things, but you know that they're just not going to go that direction. So my campaign was mostly like, hey, everyone who already knows me, this is what I want to do, and I could use your help. And then everyone kind of banded together, and momentum happened. And in the first day, I was 80% funded. So I had 29 days to make up 20%. Because it's funny, and because for what it was that I was trying to do, I could have raised more, right? That momentum could have kept coming, but once it hit that 80%, it was like, well, I've already hit the goal. I didn't really expect or anticipate to hit 50. It was sustainable with half of that. And even though it could have gotten more, and even Indiegogo as a website, like they get a cut of that. So they want me to raise more money because it works really well for them too if I raise $100,000 or $150,000. But I didn't need that much money. And I didn't want the community of people that I was asking for that much money. The more money that I have personally, individually, is sort of the more expectation I think they're going to have on what it is that's going to come out of it. So I didn't want that much money because I didn't want that expectation side of it. So my campaign was a little bit unique. I've got two other stories that aren't necessarily about me, and I think we have questions at the end, right? We're going to do like a panel thing, so we can talk more about that if you want. But back in 2011, I needed a pair of sandals. And so I found on Kickstarter that there was like two guys in California that needed $50,000 because they wanted to make sandals. And I was like, oh, well, $40. And I get some sandals in a couple of months, and they're, you know, supporting small businesses, and they're all made in the US, and everything's all cool. And these are guys that were already in sort of the fashion industry, had experience, the video was cool. They only needed $50,000. By the time that I found their Kickstarter campaign, they were up to like $200,000 raised already, because apparently they were reputable and people knew them, and people were like, I'm totally in, we all need sandals. So I put my $50 in, and then their campaign successful, thank you video, hey, we're really awesome, it's gonna be so good, we're really awesome, we need this machine, whatever else. And from then on, it was a nightmare. I mean, these were two guys who raised five times as much money as they wanted, and failed miserably, really. The machine that they needed to create the sandals needed to come from Germany, and then when it came, the machine was damaged. And then once it got there, they couldn't fit it in their building, and then they needed a new building to fit the machine in. And then in transit, the machine from one building to the other got damaged again, and then they had to order more parts. And it was like a year and a half went by, no one had any sandals. It's something really stupid, right? Sandals. You can just go to Walmart and buy sandals, it doesn't matter. But when you put money into a campaign that has an end result, you're buying a tangible item, you expect that thing to come when they say it's gonna get there. And it took 2.5 years, and believe it or not, in order to get the Kickstarter backers their sandals, they had to make sandals and sell them on South Beach first to make money back so that they could have profit to go back and make everyone else's sandals. So it's possible that you can do a successful crowdfunding campaign with a good business plan, a super good idea, super reputable people that are gonna do a good job, and it can still go totally horribly wrong. So on that side of it, like juxtaposed to the horrible side of it, where it's sandals, it's $50. I got my sandals, they were fine. I wore them around for a while, they're good sandals. But the other part of it is something like Kickstarter is used primarily for people that have either already had success in something and they want to repeat that. Like they have a good movie, like a cult classic, so then they want to raise another $2 million to make a sequel. it's awesome. Or they have a video game that worked really well, that was really popular, but then it was 20 years ago and they want to remake a sequel to that video game. So they can go and they can say, hey, everyone that was a teenager 20 years ago and now you're maybe in your 30s, do you want to give us some money to make a cooler version of that game that you loved when you were a teenager? And I'm like, totally, why wouldn't I do that? So here's some money. And hopefully I get a game back out of it, right? So crowdfunding is a different side of investing, really. You're asking people, individuals, that don't have $10,000 to spend, that don't have necessarily that big sort of higher level investment opportunity, to invest a little bit in an idea, more or less. Like the idea, like if I didn't get my sandals, it would have been okay, because they were $40, right? But when someone is giving you $40,000, I think it's a little bit different. Now, my crowdfunding campaign was $51,000 amongst 221 people. So a lot of it was like an initial upfront 10 grand, boom. And I was like, oh, that's cool. Aw, like, thank you, that's really awesome. And then it was like, boom, $10,000. Like, oh no, what am I gonna do? That's twice now that people donated $10,000. Five grand. And I'm watching this happen. Like, I get an email every time, and I'm like, I think I'm gonna throw up. It's like, wow, this is awesome. There's all this stuff happening. And then it was just really neat. The crowdfunding side of it is unique. And I imagine at scale, right, we're talking about millions of dollars, the anxiety is probably a little higher, right? But my experience was hugely positive, but at the same time, it was easy because I was asking people I already knew. And in this same space, there have been several campaigns similarly that have not gone so well. And I think specifically for WordPress, because it's open source, because it's more about values and spiritual, you know, your investment into the open source side of it, that it was by a happy accident that I didn't say, I'm gonna release three versions of these three pieces of software in 6 months. I'm going to deliver these things in this way. My campaign, and it was really just about, I want to see these pieces of software thrive in a way that they haven't been able to yet, and I'm not really sure what it is that I'm gonna be able to pull off. So my audience knew that. They were an audience of software developers or business owners or agency owners that are also software developers that get how that works. And so I could ask them very realistically to invest in the idea of momentum and putting something out there, and they trusted me. It was really me that they trusted. It wasn't necessarily the end result or the outcome. They believed in me. And that's what I think crowdfunding is, that's how it makes it different than big business, angel rounds, or investing. And there is a certain aspect of that. You are investing in someone's passion and their drive and their focus and their ability and all those things too. But for crowdfunding, I think because the audience is so different, that your experience is going to be different, and how you ask for that money is a little bit different. And, so, I guess I'm getting kicked off. So, on to the next one. Thank you.
Thanks, Jarek. I guess what I'd like to start off with is to kind of differentiate what traditional funding sources are compared to what you've heard previously. I don't have any exciting stories about funding high-tech companies and taking ownership interests in those companies, because that's not what traditional financing is all about. The best example of traditional financing that I can share with you is a bank loan. When we make a loan, we expect it to be repaid. If I was using that baseball analogy, batting 300, if only a third of my bank loans repaid, I'd have the FDIC knocking at my door pretty darn quickly and closing me down. We in fact expect probably better than 99% of our loans to be repaid. We don't take an ownership interest. We make a loan, you know, typically a term loan or a line of credit. There's variations of those, but essentially they fall into those two categories with the expectation that it's going to be repaid over time. We tend not to be the early stage investors, if you will, with those loans. The businesses tend to be more developed. We are lending, as somebody said, to the local hardware store or to the local coffee shop or to the local manufacturer. That tends to be the strength of our business. One of the things that Derek asked me to comment on was how the lending environment has changed since the recession of 2007-2008. And I thought I'd share a statistic with you that I found from a study that was conducted by the Small Business Administration This was a study of small business loans outstanding at U.S. banks. The study was completed in 2013, updated in 2014. And what they found, and by the way, the definition of small business loans for purposes of this study is a loan of $1 million or less. And what the study found was that U.S. banks had $712 billion in outstanding small business loans back in 2008. By 2012, that number had declined to about $590 billion, or about a 17% decline over that period of time. And it stayed at about that $590 billion level since, so there's essentially been no growth. And the question is, of course, why did that happen? And the recession is really the primary reason for it. Loan demand tends to fall off during periods of economic weakness or during a recession, and that certainly happened beginning in 2007, 2008. On top of that, like the consumer, a lot of the companies decided that it was best to retire debt. So we had a lot of loans that were repaying and not being replaced by demands for new loans. Add to that the need to charge off loans for businesses that failed, that didn't repay. And naturally, of course, banks tend to tighten up their underwriting criteria during times of higher risk, and you have declining loan balances outstanding. And I think that there's been some residual impacts of that recession. I think today banks tend to still be a little bit leery about taking on too much risk in their loan portfolios. I think that we still worry about how strong this economy is and how fragile it could be, how easily it could be impacted by things going on, sometimes even outside of our domestic boundaries. I think that there's concern about the consumer. If the consumer is not spending, the economy generally is not growing. And that's a key factor that we try to monitor. If they're instead going to save money or retire debt, that's not worth putting money into the economy and causing it to grow. The other residual impact of this recession for us in the banking business, which is, by the way, heavily regulated, if you didn't already know that, is that we continue to operate under tougher regulatory requirements. And that sometimes makes it a little more challenging for us to do some of the things that we would like to do. Having said that, the borrowing environment today still is very good, I think. Interest rates are at or near historic lows. For some of you that are older, you certainly remember prime rates much higher than the 3.25 that they're currently at. And so I think that it's very attractive. Banks have money to lend. The banking system remains highly liquid. So it's not a case of there not being any money available. And despite what I said about the economy, the economic news continues to generally be pretty positive. Unemployment rate is down. Manufacturing levels have picked up significantly from the recession. Other indicators of growth are increasing car sales, increasing sales of real estate, and increasing real estate values. So the net of that is that loans are, in fact, being made for a variety of purposes. But probably what's most critical is what are the characteristics of a successful borrower? And these are probably logical to you, but somebody that's been in business for a while or is an experienced business operator has historic cash flow that would be sufficient to repay the debt, there's sufficient collateral to support the loan, good credit. Those are characteristics of a loan that is probably going to be made. I don't think somebody, a borrower, company that comes to a bank for a loan with those kind of characteristics is going to have much of a difficult time getting credit or getting a loan approved. On the other hand, if you are a new business startup or you're a very young business, so you don't have that cash flow track record, or maybe it's very inconsistent, perhaps it's not sufficient to demonstrate you can repay the loan, you've had some credit problems in the past, you don't have enough collateral, or maybe you have no collateral, you're probably going to have a tough time finding getting approved from a traditional lending source like a bank. It doesn't mean it's impossible, but it makes it more of a challenge. And if you're working with a lender that has any kind of experience at all, they're going to work with you to try to figure out ways to address those weaknesses, perhaps bring in some other sources to help out. We can use things like SBA guarantees. We can partner with organizations like Receda, who has a loan program available. Maybe we can provide part of the funding, and somebody like a Lucida or a WIBIC or a WIDA can be involved with providing gap financing or other guarantees of the credit. And that's one of our goals. We often hear that that banks just don't want to make loans, and that's really not true. most banks, the far majority of their income is generated by making loans. So our objective is to make loans. We want to make loans. We don't want to turn down loans. And so our objective is to work with the borrower and try to find a way to make what might be a credit or a loan request that has merits, but maybe has some weaknesses, to find a way to make that a bankable loan, to use a term that is common in the banking industry. Again, as I said, if you're working with a lender that has some experience, the process may seem daunting, the paperwork may seem daunting, but your experienced banker should be able to guide you through that process and help you understand why we do what we need to do. And with that.
Well, thank you, Alan, and I want to thank everybody and all the speakers for taking time to be with us. I know we're kind of running toward the end of our time, so if anybody does need to leave, please feel free to do so. But at this time, I'd like to open it up for questions to any of our panelists.
Scott, I guess you could call what I have a patent on as a disruptive technology. I invented for the real industry concerning storing holes in cable. All reels made today need a transfer point. In other words, you have a small swivel. You have a swivel for hose and O-rings for electric. All cause problems. I simply eliminated the transfer point. So anybody that'd like to talk further, I'm going to hang around a little bit. Thank you.
I'd be happy to talk to you online.
So would I. I have a question for Randy. You mentioned risk-adjusted return. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, you know, in standard securities business, you can measure that pretty quantitatively. I'm curious how you would get a feel for that in an angel or a venture sort of arrangement.
Sure. Not easily. And I think it just points to, you know, what all three of us kind of talked about is you need the few home runs, you know, doubles, triples, whatever, to overcome the flat out losses. And, you know, we haven't gone into, you know, discounted cash flow and all that stuff to actually, you know, to measure that. I think I'm more just talking in a general sense that this is a high risk portion of your portfolio. You need to treat it as such. And we expect high returns off of those that are successful in order to balance and overcome the losses that we have. But you know, I think if you went to the Angel Capital Association side, ACA, funded by the Kauffman Foundation, they would probably have the metrics and the measures that you're looking for. But as an individual group, I'm not going to say that we've actually done that.
Okay. As a follow-up question, both to Scott and Randy, in addition to the return on your investment has helped mitigating some of the risk, mm-hmm. Have you guys used any other vehicles to help kind of reduce that risk, such as a buy-sell agreement?
Sure. We tend not to because it often limits some of the upside. So we have full exposure. Now we do, you know, we're not buying common stock in these companies, so we're buying preferred stock. So what that means is we're ahead of the line. So if and when there's liquidity, you know, we get our money out first. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes there's, you know, provisions called the participating preferred, which is fairly common, where you give your money out and then say you own 10% company. You also then get 10% of the broadly distributed proceeds to the common holders. So, you know, that's one form of, I guess, mitigating some of the downside risk, meaning that at least you're part of the first money out versus just being an ordinary common holder. And to your question, obviously, you know, we are measured on the performance. In our business, you know, we're more interested in the multiple than the IRR, so we're really trying to target a net 2 to 3 knots back to our LPs or limited partners investors. That tends to translate into an IRR that's in the a fund IRR that's in the, you know, low to mid 20% range. And on a deal basis, obviously, you know, the home runs are hugely huge IRRs, 70% or higher, but
winners and losers? Is there?
That's a question for Lynn on the Kiva loans. Is there an expected rate of return for people making those loans as far as a percentage of interest?
That's a great question. So Kiva, that we really all about people helping other people. So lenders on our platform really lend to the entrepreneurs fundraising out of their good heart. They don't expect a return, but the beauty of Kiva Zip is that we like a massive revolving loan fund. So once they make a $25 loan to an entrepreneur, they will get that money back as the entrepreneur repays their loan. And with the money that they get paid back, they can either withdraw or relay that to another entrepreneur fundraising. So for example, last year, I'm originally from Vietnam. I lent to $25 to a farmer in Vietnam. I got that paid back, and I used the same $25 to lend to a coffee shop in Milwaukee. And then once I get that money back, I can lend to another entrepreneur. So it's really about helping people to have an economic opportunity to start and grow the business.
I'm a local attorney, and a lot of times we have great people come to our office with good ideas, and they ask us what type of business they should be. Our preferred startup, if you will, is a limited liability company because of the flexibility, if you will. I'm assuming that when you folks come in, I really want to know, is there a preferred entity structure when you come in, or do you overlay the structure with whatever structure you're in?
Most of the companies we invest in are LLCs. Occasionally there'll be a C Corp, but you know, between the pass through for taxes and tax losses in the beginning, that's generally what we invest in. And we typically don't try to change what an entrepreneur has done. I'm not saying we wouldn't, but we typically haven't.
Yeah, unfortunately for us, it's got to be a C Corp. And there's a variety of reasons there. One, we can't have the pass-throughs back to our limited partners. And two, frankly, we get pretty specific. We prefer to Dalbar C Corp just because the corporate law is so well known and understood. And anytime you try to set up a governance structure with board, traditional board of directors and whatnot, it can be done in LLCs, as you know, it's just tricky. And then, you know, to put staff and zoning plans and things of that in place, it can be really challenging in LLC. So we did it once and we never did it again.
But it's pretty easy to overlay that once you get in.
It is. It's just really tricky. But I'll tell you that, you know, if the company, if you can bite your tongue or plug your nose as a local investor, maybe do it. I can assure you that most sizable regional investors and the coastal investors will absolutely no way won't touch it. And it actually just kind of shows naivete and just another reason for bigger investors to say no. So we flat out just won't invest in LLC.
Yeah, and I'd like to add, I haven't worked for a local payment group out of Milwaukee and kind of running the day-to-day operations. If you invest in LLC from a tax point of view, you have to wait for their tax return before you can prepare the tax return for your investors. If you have 100 investors calling you for the tax return near the end of April, you're not happy, so we prefer to invest in C-Corps as well.
Any other questions?
I have a question.
Sure.
What sort of equity stake are you taking in these businesses that you invest in? So I think you said your average investment is, what, $250,000 in a company, so where are you asking for returns for that?
Well, it's all over the board because, you know, with C, some of them are still at an idea or maybe very early prototypes, some might be further along. So part of the issue is determining the valuation, and we know that there'll be further rounds which will dilute any position that we have. But I'd be very hesitant to say what percentage that
would
be.
What's the lowest stake you've ever taken in business?
Oh, I mean, we've got 1% in some businesses, but those are much further along, and you know, we've got 25 and others.
Yeah.
It's there's really no signal that where everyone's an individual case. And sometimes we end up with convertible notes. We prefer not to do that. We'd much rather just take equity up front, but on occasion we have done convertible notes.
So for the angel investor, you mentioned that you were starting up kind of a side group that was less involved. Is that also the same criteria for people that would be able to be an angel?
Yeah, that's the accredited, that's an SEC rule for accredited investors. Yeah.
First of all, I thank Derek for putting this on for Wasilla. Thank you, it's been very helpful. But I'm real curious as you look at all of these new kind of funding sources and what has been traditionally VC funding, what are the trends in VC funding as you look at these other sources of funding and how has it impacted your work?
Yeah, no, great question. I would say in general, the trend is you know, as we probably know, the heart of our industry is in Silicon Valley. You know, the vast majority of the dollars invested and raised are out in Silicon Valley, in Boston, Austin, and you know, area. I would say the general trend in our industry is this is a bumper year. I mean, this, and it's somewhat concerning. I think in general we're worried about our industry and is there another bubble coming, because I've been with our firm since 96 and we saw what happened in 2000. So there's a lot of concern on thinking, you know, too much money flowing into the business, too much money being invested, and is this thing going to blow up? And I've actually, I keep saving articles that's, you know, on pundits saying why it's different this time, and it sounds just like 2000 again. But with that background, most funds are moving later in stage, meaning that they're unwilling to jump in at the seed early stages, and they're really allowing that burden to kind of fall onto the angel groups, because the angel communities, me in our own state, there's a much more robust angel community, say, than there was 10 years ago, when frankly there wasn't anything. There might have been one founding group called Wisconsin Investment Partners in Madison, I think was really the first institutionalized angel fund, say, that could be run with that, I think that's the case. So I think in general, we don't see these sources as competing to what we do. Actually, we think it's a great thing and we need more of it, because, you know, it's a shot cycle, okay? And we just need more things funded so, you know, that top 20% rise to the top that are investable entities that maybe we or other venture capital funds can look at. So, and these Kickstarter campaigns and all that, I think it's all good. And frankly, a lot of the crowdfunding opportunities probably aren't meant to go down the venture path anyhow. So, and generally, more capital, and, you know, I think the thing with the crowdfunding is, you know, people go in with their eyes wide open, because there's, you know, as John pointed out, there's going to be times when you don't get your sandals and you lose your $40. So I don't know if that answers your question, but that's what we're seeing.
I've got a Kickstarter investment, John, and it's in a new high-tech drone that's supposed to be delivered in February of 16. See how we do. I'll call you.
Okay.
Yeah, it might not show up.
I want to fly it.
Yeah.
I hope it comes.
Yeah, I'd like to add to that too. If you look at the financing team, the different bars, start with the founders and then their friends and family and the angels. In the industry, there's considered a funding gap past the angels, between angels and VC. So, as people are still looking for more money, and I think one of the complaints that entrepreneurs have is that there's not enough money out there. What we have seen is that we could kind of tell by the graph 150 companies last year, that there's more companies receiving funding, but the funding amounts are become smaller. So I kind of attribute that to better ideas coming out of those researchers.
Are the angel groups wringing out some of the risk prior to coming to you?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
And you could see that too in Scott's example, where the angels get a 24x return, and then your returns were lower because angels are the high risk takers.
But, you know, a lot of the things coming out of the university environment, there's exceptions, but, you know, the Brandon's group might not touch because, you know, a new wave medical, it's well understood, it's going to be $30 million. And sometimes I think there's a feeling of, oh, gee, we take on this risk and then all this further capital comes in, and there's some nasty things that happen where pay to play is meaning that if you don't participate in every round, you lose your rights and privileges. So, oftentimes, when there are really hardcore technologies coming out of the university environment, you see less of the angel activity just because the capital funds are so great.
Thank you.
Yeah, the Jobs Act of 2012 was supposed to change some of the general solicitation rules, I guess, that you guys abide by, especially in the country. Well, do you have any, and all three of you, do you have any, you know, from a SWAT perspective, is an opportunity, is a threat, the changes to general solicitation?
Well, it's interesting. I think a lot of people in our business wondered because it kind of opened up the ability to do. I mean, when we did went out and did fundraising, so they were closely held documents, and you were approaching accredited investors and institutions. I think with some of the Jobs Act, there's a feeling like you could do broader advertising with your fundraising activities. I don't think we see a lot of that in our business.
I've been noticing the billboards on 43.
No. I mean, you kind of know, I mean, when you're trying to raise a $100 million fund, you kind of know the doors you got to go knocking on, and it's probably an advertisement in the Wall Street Journal. I don't know what that's going to do.
Just a question for the panel. So we're in Walworth County, and everybody's map doesn't have anything in Walworth County. So why is that?
Well, the other thing is that we're in Walworth
County. And that's why we're here.
I think Scott mentioned it, that a lot of what we look at comes out of research universities, in Madison being an example, and I mentioned Ohio State. And some. So part of it is, you know, how close are you to those research universities? Where, I mean, we're looking, if you're going to get a 10x or 20x return, it's got to be something that is completely new and different, that is going to change people's behaviors. So that's, and the slide that Barn put up there is, it's not purely economic development. I mean, there is that aspect to it, but you know, you're doing it for a return as well, and you need those high tech kind of ideas.
Yeah, I mean, look at the map. I think 80% of the angel groups or early stage investment groups are in the Madison, Milwaukee area, and all the other ones are somehow tied to the university, maybe across Platteville. They're all looking to start something. Stevens Point now too. So unless you have the champion here that wants to start an angel group, or maybe even start with the WIN chapter, Wisconsin Innovation Network chapter, that has 500 meetings. Unless you have a champion that does something and kind of gets the people going, it's really hard to get anything.
Well, a lot of that's geographic, isn't it? Because I know, like, the state line with that company in Beloit, mm-hmm. It was just because Rock County attracted them to come into Beloit. You know, they didn't really start out in Beloit, right?
No, it was Madison, Rock County plus the majority investor. Yeah.
I would say also, like, because we're rural, because we are far from Madison, because we are 30 minutes or 60 minutes from everywhere, that people just don't look here to see what it is that we're doing. Like, I live in Easter, I moved away, lived in Boston, everywhere else, and came back because I like East Troy, I like Wisconsin, and if it wasn't for the coffee shop in East Troy, the cafe that was there, I wouldn't have met some of the like people that I share an office space with and that are building software and good ones. We call it Silicon Farms, right? Because now there's a group of 10 of us that are all into the same thing, that are building software with different languages, with different things, they're building different stuff. Some is farm tech, some is drone tech, some is all these little things that, like when I was growing up, I'd spend all winter in the garage working on a car, in the basement playing video games, and now I spend it in the office writing software. So then when spring comes, it's like this unveiling of like, look what it is that we've done over the winter in Wisconsin while we were sort of hibernating. And I don't think that people look here because I don't know that anyone else really knows to look here, or even the people that are from here that live here are looking around at what it is that other people are doing and talking about it also. So I think it's sort of a communication gap as much as it is a geographical one too. A lot of it is just being confident enough to say, hey, what do you have a sticker on your laptop too. You are in Ohio. Let's hi, and then let's figure it out, right? I don't know that we really
I would just say one thing that, and partly why, you know, we wanted you to come here too to talk particularly about venture capital, but we do at Whitewater, you know, there's the technology park there, and it's not the scale probably or volume of businesses that you find up at Madison, but we definitely have some really interesting businesses there that are technology oriented. And so, you know, how do we, and it's not, we can talk later, but, you know, how do we get more interest from the venture capital community to what we're doing in Whitewater in particular, but potentially even little spots like Kajani referenced in East Troy that are starting to crop up.
Yeah, I've been with that firm since 96. I think I looked at one business plan, just one business plan, since I've been with a firm that was out of Walla County's group in Fontana that some of you might remember, and Gary Gygax and the whole D&D thing.
Yeah.
And it was some offshoot of that, you know, 5 years or 10 years, I think he did that back in the 80s or something like that, that was doing something in the gaming space. But we're not opposed to it. But the one thing I think you need to think about is, you know, if you really, I mean, it's great to see these pockets of innovation and with Whitewater and with Johnson. I mean, ultimately, something's going to come out of that, but maybe it's not venture-backed, but it's going to be wildly successful, and, you know, you just kind of need that network effect, right? You know, one thing we think about is, okay, say someone has a really interesting idea in Lake Geneva, can you build a company to attract 200, 300, 400, 500 people to move to Lake Geneva? And frankly, we face that problem in Madison with some of our companies. I mean, my medical device company, the first thing they say is, well, you ought to go to the Twin Cities because that's where all the talent is.
So it's, and on the software side of it, the company that I spent the most time with, Automatic, is distributed. So for a while, there was no office. There was no corporate office. Everyone worked from wherever they lived. I mean, when I started, there were 60 employees that were all around the world. So there were pockets of people we would all communicate with IRC or on a series of blogs or whatever on projects and have tools so that we could collaborate online. So a lot of it, too, is if you're going to get a business that's here, a lot of the times people aren't going to want to relocate to Wisconsin for a job like that. They already have a family or a home. If you're writing software, you can write software anywhere. You have the internet. You just do that. So a lot of it, too, is people don't think to look here because they are looking for Silicon Valley. They're looking, I hate the word, but it's everyone gravitates. They gravitate towards the bigger idea. Even if you start off with something, you orbit towards whatever the big one is. You go to Madison, you go to Milwaukee, go to California, because there's big ideas, big money, big momentum with lots of people. So people don't come back and say, what's on the dark side of the moon? What are you looking at in a place where no one's looking? No one looks here for that. And there's something there, right? But whether or not it's for the right investors that are paired up with the right startups or the right ideas, I think it's a niche group. It's a niche group of investors that are looking to support a niche idea for people that don't have the big network that you have when you, you know, born and raised in East Troy, right? Like, you have to go out and find that bigger network of people and hopefully bring some of that back with you when you come back to the Wallet Valley.
Does venture ever go out and invest in, like, the new McDonald's, the new Arby's, the new fast food store that's going to develop? Is that something that venture ever puts money into, or angles where it's an idea of a product that I just will sell into, you know, 3,000 chains of stores all across the country, or is that something that you go to Bob Clocker or Mr. Larson for?
Yeah. Oh, we don't, but certainly within our industry, there's groups that have interest in franchise models and on those types of things. And a number of the franchises are venture backed. It's just not something we don't see much of it, and so we don't have the expertise, and it wouldn't be something our firm would do, but I think in general those types of businesses are venture backed.
Yeah. And thank you all of you for coming. I really appreciate that.
Just the state lighting to invest in